Did you know in just 1 year, Americans like you and I use 580 million gallons of gasoline in our lawnmowers just to mow our grass? 580 million gallons of gasoline, that's a lot of fuel that could be saved. Coming up next on Wildlife Matters, we're going to challenge you to get rid of the idea that you need a lot of turf grass and exotic plants in your landscape and convince you to use Florida native plants and wildflowers instead, which are very beautiful, good for the environment, and best of all, don't require mowing.
This program is made possible by OUC, the reliable one, committed to weaving sustainability through everything they do, while providing clean, reliable, and affordable energy and water to their customers. Learn more at OUC.com and by the following generous contributors.
Florida native plants and wildflowers, beautiful, low maintenance, hardy, and they come free with every piece of land in our state. So why do we plow them over and destroy them when a development goes up, then bring in exotic plants and turf grass to take their place, both of which require lots of water, maintenance, and mowing? Hi everyone, I'm Tracy McCommon, and thanks for joining us for Wildlife Matters. On today's program, we'd like to change the way you think about Florida native plants and wildflowers and make you realize they're not just weeds to be pulled up and plowed over. They're a very significant part of our Florida ecology to be cherished and preserved. In fact, Florida native plants and wildflowers are so important to offset their loss from what we call progress. Developers and homeowners should plant native plants and wildflowers in as many yards and public areas as possible. I'd like to introduce you to three Central Florida homeowners who've used Florida native plants and wildflowers to sculpt magnificent yards. You'll see how their native yards look great, require very little maintenance, and best of all, help preserve the brilliant plant life that make Florida unique. Florida native plants, plants indigenous to Florida, plants that existed prior to human impacts, plants associated with our natural ecosystems. Aura Barisi knows native plants and wildflowers. She's a member of the Florida Native Plant Society and is the owner of our first example of a native plant yard. She lives on the outskirts of Orlando, Florida, in an area called Longwood, with her husband and two children. Aura has channeled all she's learned about native plants into her beautiful yard, now bursting with Florida native plants and wildflowers. It's her very own sanctuary, and it's right outside her front door, a wonderful place where she finds peace.
When I'm sitting in the chair watching the butterflies, it really is. It's very peaceful out here. Most people have to go and picnic at a state park. We don't have to. We can come out here, have lunch, watch the butterflies, watch the bees, and you know, we've got it all right here. It's wonderful.
Planting with Florida native plants and wildflowers has become a rewarding activity for Aura. Because of their low maintenance, superior performance, and drought tolerance, Florida native plants and wildflowers have been easy for Aura to get addicted to. You can tell by looking at her yard, she's definitely passionate. Let's find out how Aura went about creating her beautiful native plant yard.
When we bought the property, it had been neglected for quite a few years. Basically, there was the large trees, the oaks, the magnolia in the center of the front yard were all here. The front yard consisted of sand and weeds. Foundation plantings were pretty awful, not worth keeping. The backyard, they had tried to grow grass under the pines, not successfully. So we pretty much started from scratch. Coming up the property from the street, I've tried to keep everything in the backyard. You come through the backyard into the property. I've tried to keep it native, 100% native, very minimal irrigation. It's longleaf pine, sandhill type of vegetative naturally, and that's what I've tried to replicate with my plantings. Coming closer to the house, I've done the normal landscaping around the house to hide the foundation plantings. The front yard is a combination of perennial border, however, using native plants as my showpieces rather than the typical English type plants. And then I have an area of oaks, which I have put plants that are more northern Florida, north central Florida plants that give me more of a lush undergrowth. So, Ora, if you had to pick your three most favorite plants in your whole yard, what would they be? That's hard. The native plants, probably this one right here, would be one of my favorites. It's Chondrodina canensis, is the Latin name. The common name is false rosemary, and it grows native in Florida. It has a green and a gray variety, which makes you have different colors if you'd like them. It's evergreen in the winter, which is just wonderful. We have few plants that are evergreen in the winter. Mm. Has a beautiful bloom in the spring. Absolutely gorgeous, very fragrant, kind of a pink purple color. And the honeybees just cover the plant.
Wow.
So it's a wonderful plant all season long.
So this is your number one favorite plant in the yard?
I think that it is.
So, Ora, out of your top three favorite native plants in your yard, what would number two be?
It would have to be this cassia. This is called Bahama cassia. Cassia mexicana is the Latin name for it. And it, again, is an evergreen plant, which is always a favorite in a native plant garden. It is the larval plant for the yellow sulfur butterfly, which means that they lay their eggs on it and the caterpillars eat the leaves, so that it provides me with more butterflies. Mm. It blooms the yellow flowers on and off year-round, which makes it that much more attractive.
Well, attracting the yellow sulfur butterfly, well, that's always a positive.
Always.
Out of the top three native plants in your yard, what would number three be?
Have to be the white penstemon. This is the most versatile, attractive, showy plant that I think I have. It goes dry to moist, which is very valuable in a native plant, adaptability, to an average garden condition. It doesn't have to be on a scrub hill to look beautiful. It has these beautiful blooms for a long period of time in the summer. It attracts all big honeybees that are having the problems with the ticks. And so we like to feed those especially. Mm. And it's just a stand upright, stand out native plant.
It's definitely very showy and beautiful, that's for sure.
As you see, native plants and wildflowers not only bring unique beauty to your yard, they also bring life to your yard. Native plants and wildflowers help provide an environment in which insects, birds, and animals can live and reproduce.
The wildlife to this yard has been unbelievable. When we first moved here, there was not one butterfly, not one caterpillar. I didn't even have earthworms. Now I sit and enjoy the garden in the afternoons. I watch the butterflies, I watch the wildlife come in and use the yard, and mostly stay because I've provided the larval plants and the housing necessary for them to make this the home. And that's my biggest benefit, is my reward of watching the wildlife.
Ora has learned it's much easier to design with nature than against her. Using Florida native plants and wildflowers in her landscape saves her water, energy, and work, and helps provide homes for our vulnerable wildlife.
One person can't do everything, but there's a philosophy now that if you have enough little islands that join each other through a subdivision, through a city, that the wildlife can manage to go from island to island and survive. And that's, I feel, what we're able to do here, is we have a little bit larger property than some people. I'm able to provide a lot of different habitats. And it's a little bit of respite for the wildlife as they try to move across the corridors of suburbia.
Aura lives on the outskirts of Orlando in a rural area with no homeowners association. But Eugene Staccardo, the owner of our second example of a native plant yard, lives in the heart of downtown Orlando in a new subdivision with an active homeowners association. His yard is very small, but it hasn't stopped him from creating a dramatic landscape using Florida native plants and wildflowers.
The gardens vary every day. They change constantly. They're not a static thing. So that we get a lot of joy going out and seeing what's flowering at this time of year. If you come back in a month, the yard is going to look totally different because every season, every month is different. It transitions from yellow flowers in the beginning of the summer, early spring, to blue and purple flowers in the end of summer and then the autumn. In this early spring, the plums come out and they're totally white. You know, so it's always fun to look at that. Some of our plants provide potential food for us and also food for birds and insects. The plums provide flowers for honeybees and native bees, but they also provide plums, which we can make jellies and pies out of later. So it's the whole gamut. First we came up with a plan, and then we looked at the area and took clues from the area, which was in downtown Orlando, and our area was old longleaf flatwoods type situation, sandhill community. So we knew we had sandhill plants, and we also had the soils that would do that. So then we went ahead and chose those species that would fit into a sandhill community.
Xeriscaping is the practice of matching the right plants with the right conditions in a yard to help reduce the use of water, fertilizer, pesticides, and labor. Let's find out which Florida native plants and wildflowers Eugene chose for his yard and where he chose to plant them.
Starting on the front, on the west side, it gets hot afternoons, so we place a couple of longleafs, which eventually will help block that side, along with the plum, which helps block the sun on the lower section, on the first story. Those plants are tolerant of pretty warm weather. On the northwest corner, is starting to transition. In the summertime, that area gets lots of sun, so those plants are tolerant of very warm temperatures. But as you move towards the north side, that's where you get the oak leaf hydrangea, crab apple. That's more of a northern situation. Part of that is it needs more shade, hence that's the north side of the house. As you move around towards the east side, that gets morning sun to mid-afternoon sun. That's why we planted the red bud there. The firebush is tolerant of warm. It could tolerate most of the day, but it helps them not having that real hot afternoon. The south side is plants that can tolerate hot weather. That's where the longleaf flatwoods garden is. The vegetable garden's on that side because in the wintertime, which is the garden time here, it gets sun. All the herbs are on that side because they want sun and warmth throughout the year.
Plants are the main source of energy in an environment, giving life to a wide variety of insects, birds, and animals. The leaves, bark, twigs, roots, seeds, fruit, and nuts are all eaten by wildlife. Eugene's yard has a wonderful variety of native food plants animals enjoy, but his location does have its limitations.
It's a very urban area, so we do not have much in the way of, you know, I would love to have gopher tortoises, but we don't have any. It's mainly the small insects that we have. Butterflies, we do have pipe vine swallowtails, giant swallowtails, gulf litterays, yellow sulfurs, white sulfurs, and a lot of the species that we provide here are specifically to help support the butterflies. They are nectarine, but also more importantly, larvae, because a lot of times people don't have the right plants for the butterflies to larvae on. You know, so if you want gulf litterays, you better have some passion vine around someplace. If you want zebra swallowtails, you might have pawpaw around.
In addition to helping preserve the vegetation and wildlife that make Florida unique, landscaping with native plants and wildflowers helps reduce the amount of pollutants entering our water bodies because native landscaping requires fewer chemicals. Planting a variety of native plants and wildflowers creates a natural balance.
I have never sprayed anything in this yard. The vegetable gardens benefit because there's so many insects that no caterpillars will make it in the yard for more than a few days because the wasp will get them. So I don't have to. I don't have problems of worms on my tomatoes. I don't have any type of insect problems. So that's a benefit of going with a large number of species. If you plant just grass and one or two other species, that's a monoculture, meaning a very singular type species, and you're gonna have problems. We don't spray. We're not putting the chemicals into the ground, which we someday will drink.
Our third example of a native plant and wildflower yard is owned by Marjorie Holt, also a member of the Florida Native Plant Society. She lives in an older community in East Orlando. Marge's yard is of moderate size, but it's extremely unique. Not only does she have a lot of beautiful Florida native plants and wildflowers on her property, but many of her plants are endangered, threatened, or species of special concern. Her pleasure comes from tending her incredible collection.
The happiest times are when I'm creatively out here with my hand clippers or planting or just doing my little maintenance things. Like to work in the morning, and that's an active time for the birds and many of the animals. So it's fun just to be out here and digging and pruning and maintaining the yard.
So how did Marge go about creating her fascinating native plant and wildflower yard?
After I decided that I liked or thought native plants would be for me, I consulted with a native landscape architect, and I also found a native nursery, Green Images, located in Christmas, Florida. I had a landscape plan drawn up that I could work with over time. It has expanded greatly since its conception, but just finding a contact in the Native Plant Society helped. In the front yard, the area is dominated by silver saw palmetto. I have about 30 kuntis, which is a species of special concern. And there's a scrub area, a little strip. I've got Palifoxia fahi, a little bit of the tick seed, and I have the Gulf muley. That's a grass. I also have a summer hawthorn There is a eastern gamma grass and a coral honeysuckle by the mailbox. In the pond area on the side yard on the west side, I have pickerel weed and the fragrant lily pad. Those are the emergence in the pond. In the backyard along the woods, it's dominated with ferns. I have a couple of the royal ferns. And then moving towards the other side is another small pond with the some more emergence and the button bush, which is a bush, a wetland bush. Then there's numerous gallberries planted on the east side, which I'm trying to grow up for a hedge type effect. And then moving back, or I should say forward, to the front side yard, there is a rescued palmetto.
Getting to know her Florida native plants has been a real thrill for Marge. However, she does have her favorites.
The three favorite plants in my yard, although this is hard to define, the Hypericum reductum, which is the scrub St. John's wort, is virtually maintenance-free once it gets established. It's a ground cover, and it blooms. It stays green through the winter. The tropical sage is a favorite to the butterflies, the other pollinators, the hummingbird. It blooms most of the season. And I like the silver saw palmettos. They're, to me, indicative of Florida's landscape.
The daily experience of watching her native plants and wildflowers grow and observing the wildlife that visit her yard is very important to Marge.
My husband and I enjoy the diversity that has been attracted to our yard. There's numerous birds and the pollinators, the bees and the different bugs and just a whole host of different animals that utilize these plants.
Florida has over 3,600 native plant species, making it one of the most biologically rich areas in the United States. Unfortunately, because of widespread development, 528 species of Florida native plants are either endangered or threatened, and another 8 are listed as commercially exploited. That's another reason Marge's yard is so exceptional. She rescues Florida native plants and wildflowers and gives them safe harbor on her property.
I believe that I am making a difference. I believe that one person can make a difference, make a big difference. So if I can be a role model for others to encourage others in the neighborhood to plant and attract in their yard, then it's worth it.
Most wildlife are not able to live on a typical residential lot. But if neighbors join together and create multiple native plant and wildflower areas adjacent to each other, more of our native species can survive.
Everybody should create a small area for themselves. You can do it in a townhouse, you can do it in a quarter acre lot, you can do it in a 3-acre piece of property. Create a small area, use native plants preferably, and enjoy it. And before you know it, you'll be addicted. And you'll be passionate about native plants.
Planting native plants and wildflowers in our landscapes is one good way to help protect Florida's native fauna, but it's not the best way. The best way is to protect these plants in their native ecosystems by preserving large tracts of land untouched by human hands. But with millions of homes in Florida and more being built every day, the least we can do as citizens is to try and preserve some of Florida's natural environment in our gardens through the planting and propagation of Florida native plants and wildflowers as we continue to remember, wildlife matters.
To locate a Florida native plant nursery near you, log on to the Association of Florida Native Nurseries website at www.afnn.org. To find out about joining the local chapter of the Florida Native Plant Society, log on to their website at www.fnps.org.
This program is made possible by OUC, the reliable one, committed to weaving sustainability through everything they do, while providing clean, reliable, and affordable energy and water to their customers. Learn more at OUC.com and by the following generous contributors. To share your feedback about this program or to order a copy of Unique Landscapes Using Florida Native Plants, plus additional programs in the Wildlife Matters series, please visit our website at www.naturewisetv.org. Wildlife Matters is created and produced by NatureWise Incorporated, dedicated to improving the environment through educational television and video.